So, one, it's about evolution of management and different school of thoughts of management. The evolution of management is talking about how management started. Are you with me? So, it started around 1100 before Christ. And the Chinese practice four principles, four functions of management, which are planning, leading, organizing, and controlling. So the Chinese people really started management in 1100 BC by practicing four functions. You know, basically the functions of management are represented in police, where P is planning, O is organizing, L is leading, I is innovating, C is controlling, then E is employee staffing, So now, after that time, between 400 BC and 350 BC, the Greek, that's Greece, now, sees management as an art and then advocated scientific management. Are you with me? So what that is saying is that now the Greek, they see management as something that is inborn. That is, you have a natural ability to manage things, people or resources. You know, there are five M's of management. You have man, machine, method, money, and material. These are the resources available to every organization. Are you with me? All organizations, these are the resources. Man is talking about the human resources, machines, methods, money, financial resources, and materials. So, the Greece before, between 400 BC and 350 BC, they see that anybody that can manage these five things has the natural ability. That's the meaning of management as an art. So they now believe that, no, we should be able to train people to manage. When they are trying to train people to manage, that's what we call scientific management. But when that thing is inborn, it's part of them, management as an art. You can even see, they can ask the question, what can we say about management as a science and management as an art? They are just trying to talk about people having the natural ability to be able to do something and then training people to be able to do that thing. So when people follow training process, that's scientific. But when it looks natural, then that's as an art. Do you get that? And then later, the Venetians, that's it now. That's standardized production. So they brought in management process into production. And then the industrial revolution now makes management to be a discipline. It now makes it to be something someone can study as a course or a university. So this is the history of management. I'll summarize it for you. Will you get started from China? They practice four principles of management, four functions of management. And then later, the Greeks saw management as an art. They decide to make it a science. That is, don't let's leave management to people who have the natural ability only. Let's look forward to training people to manage. You get? And then later, people brought in management to how they produce. And then industrial revolution. Industrial revolution is the age where there's mass production through machine. And then there was need for education. And so that now made management to be a discipline. Okay, so the different school of thoughts that we have in management is like saying different people view management differently. Are you with me? The way you see management is not the way I see it, and it's not a crime. We can see the same thing differently. This COVID now, some people believe it exists. Some say it does not exist. So are you with me now? So there are different people too who saw management differently. And so we have three schools of thought. The three schools of thought is represented by MTN. Are you with me? M for modern school or contemporary school. T for traditional or classical school. The N for neoclassical or organic school. Are you with me? Then the modern contemporary school is divided into contingency school or system school. Huh? Now, when you want to talk about each of them, you have to talk about their founders. So the person that formed contingency school is Chester Bennett. Now, how did he see management? He said that management should be based on what is happening in an organization. That is, you should not have a particular style of management. It is the way things happen that you should manage it. If you have staff that are very stubborn, be stubborn with them. If you have staff that are gentle, be gentle with them. If you have staff that are in between, you to be in between. Just make sure that whatever approach is best is what you are adopting. Are you with me? At any time you are managing people or resources. And the next one, system school of thought, you have Edward Fidler. Edward Fidler said that now management is a system. Are you with me? Management is a system, and that system, every system involves input, process, and output. Are you with me? So, system school of thought believes that management is a process which has input, process, and output. Now, for example, he sees management as the new student who just entered school, the matriculant, 100 level student. They will pass through a process for 4 years. Let's say they study economics and then they graduate. So, as at the time they want to enter school, they are new class. They will now have to pass through 4 years program process and then they become output, which is graduate. So, he believes that everything works that way. He also said that if you go to a manufacturing company, factory, you know they will have raw material. By the time they process the raw material, it becomes an output. So there's always an input, that's the raw material. It will pass through process and becomes what? An output. So he sees management as a process of starting point, pass through a process, and then have the end point. That's the way he sees management. Okay, are you with me? Then we now have the traditional classical school of thought. Under that, we have scientific school and administrative school. Are you with me? Now, the scientific school of thought is by Frederick Winslow Taylor, F.W. Taylor. And then he sees management as something that is systematic in nature. That is, when you are doing anything, when you want to employ people, when you want to manage people, follow a particular order. Let there be a systematic order of doing things. So he believes that staff should be scientifically selected. That is, people who are capable to do a job and fit a position are the people you should put there. And then when people are working, let them use time. Don't let them work anyhow. So there must be a process. So he believes in scientific selection of staff, scientific process of working. Mm-hmm. And so,
it was one with the 14 principles of management.
No, it is this one.
So
the administrative school of thought by Henry Fayol is the one that talked about 14 principles of management. The 14 principles is what I represent by add our things.
The question came at number one. Yes, in one of our courses.
Do you remember?
I wrote everything. Yes, I don't know. I just got to somewhere. I just decided to study 1 to 14.
So add our things. So where you have authority, discipline, division of labor, order, unit of command, unit of direction, remuneration, decentralization, esprit de corps, equity, initiative, scalarship, subordination, and stability of them. Those are the 14 principles.
Okay, so
that order. Add our
things. This T is what?
T. Centralization.
Oh.
But it's DE. No. It's different from this. What I actually want to say there is centralization.
Oh.
So that I can have meaning. So I have to put D.
Okay.
You understand? It's actually talking about centralization.
That's my cramming.
So that is the one that talked about 14 principles of management. And of course, we now have the neoclassical school of thought, which is human relations school and what? Bureaucratic school of thought. Now, under the human relations school, the human relations school is saying that in an organization, try to focus on the people that are working, not the work. Take care of your people. When you take care of your people, you take care of the work. Do you get? And then bureaucratic school of thought, Max Weber, is talking about that every system, management should be in hierarchy. Are you? It should be in hierarchy. That is, just like your place of work now, there is hierarchy, is that not? You have the topmost head. Who is the topmost head?
Coordinator.
The coordinator. After coordinator.
Office head. Head of office.
Head of office.
Then head of unit.
Show yourself. There's
more small managers managing
the law. That's what this guy is saying. That's what you call management. He believes in hierarchy. Let there be hierarchical order for leadership. Let's have the person that is topmost, followed by the next, followed by the next, followed by the next to the lowest. Do you understand? So this is the summary of the return. So any question? Okay, so unit 2 is talking about definition of management, the nature of management, function of management, and purpose of management. So management, of course, is defined as the process of designing and maintaining an environment. Designing and what? Maintaining an environment. What that means is that when you want to start a business and you want to manage it, you must plan how you want to manage. That okay, my entrance will be there, secretary will be there, accountant will be there, and then we will be resuming 8 to 5. All of those things are what we call design. And then you maintain it, you keep to it. Not that we come today, we resume 11 o'clock. Tomorrow staff will resume 8 o'clock. No. Let it be that you have planned some things and then you keep at it. That's the meaning of maintaining. So, designing and maintaining an environment where individuals can work together efficiently. The word efficiently means that you are achieving your goal and then you are minimizing resources. So, efficiently means doing things right. Effectively means doing right things. They are different. Doing things right, doing right thing. You may be doing the right thing at the wrong time. So you may be effective but not efficient. But you can't be efficient without being effective. So what we are saying now is that the people must be able to work together to achieve goals at a minimal usage of resources, not wasting it. Now, if you build a house, two bedroom flat with 4 million, and another person build two bedroom flat with 8 million, the same thing inside, you are more efficient than that person. You both achieve the same goal, but you use less resources. The other person uses more resources. So the person is less efficient. You are more efficient because you achieve the same goal with the lesser resources. So that's what this is saying. So efficiently to achieve selected what? Aims. Okay. So we now said that. What's the nature of management? Now, all managers carry out what we call managerial function. If you say there's any management anywhere, they must be carrying out managerial function, which are functions of management, police. Anything you call management anywhere, they must be planning, organizing, leading, innovating, controlling, and employing staff. Are you with me? Anything called management applies to all kind of organization. You know, in school here, we have management. In your school where you finish from, should be you have management. Where you are working now, you have management. You will be shocked if you go to all these madam selling things there. They have somebody managing them. Maybe people that come and collect all this fee from them. You tell them, don't pass this place, don't use more than that place. So management applies to all forms of organization. And it is important to any level. Now, because there are levels of management, the levels of management, you have the top level management, we have the middle level management, and then we have the lower level management. Are you okay? The top level management makes use of what we call conceptual skill. They are the one that think. This one makes use of what we call human relation skill. And this last one is what we call technical skill. Are you with me? The person that talked about levels of management is called Henry Mintzberg. And the person that talks about skill is Robert Katz. So he said that, so like this, it is important in any level of management. That is, management is important at top level, at middle level, and at lower level. So and then the aim of all management is what? It's the same, to achieve their goal. If you have management in the university, they have a goal and they want to achieve it. Management in the organization where you work, they have a goal and they want to achieve it. Have you? So anywhere that you have management, their goal is always to achieve whatever aim they want to achieve. And then the last one is that it is concerned with productivity. Management wants everybody to be productive. Like you now, where you work, they want you to be productive. They don't want you to be story. They use KPI for you, right?
KPI.
In your place of work for promotion. If they want to promote you, they will have to check your KPI, your key performance index or key performance indicator.
Key performance indicator. That one is for report. Performance measure.
Performance measure. So that is the one to check, do you really do what you're supposed to do? Are you due for promotion or not? Things like that. So, that's what productivity is about. They want to see whether you are doing what you're supposed to do. Do you get?
Yeah.
So and then we have purpose of management. Of course, the purpose of management is to use the five M's efficiently and effectively. What are the five M's?
Man,
mentor, material, money, like that. So efficiently means doing the right thing. Effectively means doing things right. So they want both to be achieved. Do it right and do the right thing. You get it? So this is what the two is all about. Okay, So unit 3 is talking about values of management. Now when we are talking about values of management, that is, it's like saying what are the benefits that management has. When you have management in the place, why is it important? So number one, to keep pace with what? With the environment. Now when you say to keep pace with the environment, it is the management that helps an organization to manage the business environment, which is the next thing we are going to. Because business environment is divided into two, internal and external. The internal business environment are those business environments that are controllable by the business. So it includes shareholders, creditors, union, board of directors, employees. And then the external environment, of course, that one is political, economic, you understand? So it is the management that helps any organization to say, okay, this is what is happening now, let's do this, let's do that. So they help the organization to keep pace with the business environment.
How is the acronym you get for external environment?
Pest Glad. I will still get there.
Okay.
This for external business environment. Political factor, economic factor, social, cultural, technological, globalization, legal, international factor. Example of this international factor is COVID. That can affect business, and business does not have control by it. So, demographic and ecological. So, combining factors of production, it is also the duty of management to combine the factors of production. You know, the factors of production we have is land, labor, capital, and what? Entrepreneur. So, is the one that helps to manage this thing in an efficient way. Are you okay? Is the management. Then to get best from human resources. You know, the most important resources of any organization are the people. So how you manage them well determines what you get as an organization. So these three are the values of management. So they are the reason why management is very important to any organization. Then we now have management as a science, then management as an art. Now we say management is a science because there is an existence of body of knowledge which can be scientifically determined. That is, any time you are talking about management, you always have some set of principles, and those principles can be determined. And that's why if you are in an organization, they can train you to be a manager. They can say, if you want to be a manager, make sure you come to work early, make sure you do this one, all your staff do this one. You understand? There are things you can follow. So, but when you are talking about management as an art, it's the application of the acquired knowledge to solve real life problems or what? Situation. It's one thing to acquire knowledge, it's another thing to use it. To now use your own sense and add it to that knowledge and then solve the problem. So, management as an art, as it was talking about, you already have a training, but you now go to a T-junction where that training is not enough. You have to add your own common sense to solve the problem. That's management as an art. But the fact that there are body of rules and principles you can learn as a person to become a manager is what we refer to as management as a science. Do you get that?
Yes.
Okay. Okay, so unit 4 expect us to talk about management and administration and then environmental factors of managers. Are you? Now when you are talking about management and administration, we have to find what management is. Are you? So management happens at all levels of management. Top level, middle level, lower level. Just like you are telling me about your piece of work, there are different levels of management. But anytime you are talking about administration, are you with me? Administration takes place only at the top level. So the topmost people where you work are the one you can call performing administration. Why? Because all the admin work that will be going on there, they are the one who is going to give the imperatives. Are you with me now? So while management happens across all levels of management, administration occurs only at what?
Top
level management. Don't forget to. That's the major difference. So, should in case they ask you to write about it, you can now support it with so many other stuff. But that's the basic thing. Management happens across. Administration happens only at the top. That's the difference between management and administration. Okay? And then environmental factors, you have the internal factor. The internal factors, of course, are the controllable what? Controllable factors, have you? The factors that the manager can control, the business can control. But the external factors are the what? Uncontrollable factors. So the uncontrollable factors are now divided into general environment and task environment. So the general environment is what we call first guide, and the task environment is a customer, competitor, supplier, and what? Distributor. So, and all of these are in one way or the other affect business environment. You know, political factor, politics, if they make any political move now, of course, if they want to do election, you know, they will ask you to stay at your house. So as a business person, your business will be affected. Is that not? Because everybody has to go and vote. Economic factor has to do with resources, whether people are poor or rich. You know, if too many people are poor, they won't be able to patronize businesses. That's another factor that affects business. Sociocultural factor has to do with culture in a place. Culture in a place affects business. Is that not? If, for example, there's a culture in a place where people must put on clothes that cover the whole of their body, it's only their face that should be showing. And then you are now selling armless clothes. It won't sell. Because it does not go with their culture.
Yes.
Technology is another factor that affects business. You agree with me?
Yes.
The use of phone, computer, internet has made some businesses to be online. They don't need to see you, they come and supply you, you pay them, you know, things like that. Globalization has affected business. The world is now a global village. You can be here and be doing business with somebody in the US. And then you will make your money and you just keep quiet. Nobody knows. Inside your room. So, legal factor, that's law. Laws that are made always affect business. You know, if they make some laws that are, they now ban Tokyo. Nobody should eat Turkey. And then people are still selling Turkey. They will be small units. So it will affect the business. International factor, you know, like this code is now. Something will happen internationally somewhere and it will affect you. This thing started from China and all of a sudden it affected Nigeria. The demographic or fiscal factor is talking about location of the business. Are you with me? Location of business affects the business. We are some businesses are located in the place that it is because of that place they are, that's why they are selling so much. And some, their business is good, but where they are is not helping the business. People don't know they are there, maybe they are in one corner. So then, ecological factor is talking about weather. Weather condition can also affect business. Like, you know, this time that rain is falling, people producing umbrella might likely sell more, have you? People producing ice cream and all this fine yogurt, whatever, people may not really patronize them because the weather is not really hot. You understand? So, and of course, the task environment, customer is one factor that can affect business seriously. Then the same thing with your competitor. They can make your business to go down if they are doing so well than you. But if you are doing better than them, of course, you will be in business. Supplier also can affect your business. Because they don't supply you on time, or they always have issues. Then distributor also. Your distribution channel can affect your business. So all of these things are environmental factors of what? Of managers. And they can affect businesses. Okay, are you clear with that?
Yeah.
Okay.